you were not ready.
Delhi problem. Cost of
Hello, Okiles, Rabha.
Okay.
Start Kuribo Paribo, 1 minute, right. 1 second.
Right. Right.
Okiles, you can see.
Can you resume? Yeah, thank you. And sorry for the interruption. I was talking about the different maladaptive coping strategies, and without going to details, I was talking about a substance use behavior, that is alcohol to be specific. And when we talk about substance use behavior, we know that in our brain, there is a particular reward circuit area from nucleus accumbens to ventral tegmental area. When dopamine level is increased, there is a craving for substance. Not necessarily this reward circuit has to be activated by only maladaptive coping strategies like substance. There are other ways which are healthy coping, which can also activate this particular circuit. In context to that comes the often said terminologies like temptation and willpower. These two words can also be biologically traced. As our brain matures initially during our childhood and adolescence, the subcortical structures like the amygdala, limbic system, basal ganglia are matured fast. And these are related to pleasure principles, like a child wants something immediately, and they want that without thinking about the consequences. But whatever we do is represented in the cortex. We call it corticalization. There is the mapping of the events in the cortex. With age, the cortex matures, specifically the prefrontal cortex. And as we have talked earlier, through the inputs from ventromedial prefrontal cortex, we learn new and new things. We see each event having their positive and negative outcomes. And accordingly, we have a controlling mechanism, the prefrontal cortex working like superego, in contrast to the subcortical structures working like an id. And this id, if we compare to child, the superego is like our guardian or parents having a controlling mechanism. So we need higher functions of the cortex in order to inhibit the pleasure seeking functions of the subcortical structure. In other words, we need to strengthen the circuits which determine the willpower to inhibit the circuits that determine the temptation. This is a very famous Amitabh Bachchan blockbuster, Sarabi. I'm sure all of us have watched this movie, where there's a famous dialogue, Amitabh Bachchan, who says, apni jindagi ka tambu teen bamboo pe khada hai, sharab, shayari, and munshi ji. Though very popular, I feel that it has a very definite medical and biological connotation to this remark. Sharab is a drug having biological actions. If we take substance use as a psychiatric disorder, there are other psychiatric disorders as well, which having biochemical changes. And those changes can be reversed through molecules, different psychiatric treatments. Now, talking about theory, it is related to one's psyche. Some leisure time activities, some likes to write poems, some painting, some gardening. These are things which we can also compare to something called temptation and willpower, that is the psychological makeup of an individual. Now, the Munshiji, who always accompanies Amitabh Bachchan, represents the support system in the form of family and our friends. If those support system is not very healthy, we need to replace it with something which will be more beneficial in times of crisis. So in other words, if we talk about the different biochemical molecules that can reverse the disorders, which is represented by psychiatry, then this temptation and willpower, the psychological makeup of an individual, can be attempted by the field of clinical psychology. And coming to the family or social support system, it is the domain of psychiatric social work with inputs from community nursing. So thus, a multidisciplinary approach working hand in hand, psychiatry, clinical psychology, psychiatric social work with inputs from community nursing, can turn the unhealthy tambu representing Sarab Sayari and Munshiji with a healthy tambu representing psychiatry, clinical psychology, and psychiatric social work, which will make us a complete human being, which will make us competent to face a crisis situation like what we are currently going through. As Leo Tolstoy has said, the two most powerful warriors are patience and time. Ken Williamson, the most very highly liked cricketer, the New Zealand captain, I like to conclude what he had to say. Quote, people talk about the pressure sportsmen and women are under to perform, but the truth is we get to do something we love every day for a living. We play games. He continued, real pressure is working to save lives. Real pressure is going to work every day while putting your own personal safety on the line for the good of others. It is an enormous responsibility that can only be carried out by the best kind of people, those who put the greater good ahead of all else. Thank you. My speech will be followed by one from the clinical psychologist and another by psychiatric social worker, and we are allotted 40 minutes each, but I have still got 5 minutes time to take question and answer session.
Ramana Zanil, Ramana Zanil. Good afternoon, everybody. I am Dr. Maitli Hazarika, Associate Professor of Clinical Psychology from Guwahati Medical College. Today in the morning, I just saw this picture in Assam Tribune that is on the right side and left side is the West. Now we see a confluence between West and East at this point of time. So that is the only good thing, I guess. We are in the same boat, brother, from Dr. Bhupen Hazarika's song. Why health professionals are most stressed now? Because they're at risk for infection and psychological distress due to change in work habits, deal with unpredictability, and they lack sometimes the communication and feedback about what work they have to do. And that creates a lot of confusion and helplessness at this point of time. Is distress universal? What I understand is the stress that we are going through is universal at this point of time. Some reasons that I've quoted here is because of the uncertainty, what is going to happen tomorrow, about the disease process, the progression of the disease, nobody knows. And many a times it is speculated, so many different speculations are happening that it could be from blood transmission, it could be because of the air, because of different surfaces, hard, soft. I mean to say there are a lot of things that are going on in the whole world. The mixed messages that are coming because research is not being done yet. It is still in the process. So basically the uncertainty also leads to a lot of stress, as we all know. The fear of dying and death, that is an universal fear that all of us have. And the unpreparedness, we were not prepared for something like this. It was very sudden. And this suddenness had made life very uncertain for all of us. And the lack of adequate knowledge, because we have less knowledge about such a disaster or a crisis because it is unprecedented. Never we had come across such a situation in the whole world. And we are not used to adaptability. We are non-adaptable people. We have some rigid rules and regulations in doing things. We have a structured routine. So we just cannot adapt to such an extent. So probably that is creating a lot of stress in us. And we are not flexible as human beings. Many a times, the flexibility, the change is something we have to learn to accept. Extremely anxious people are. There are a lot of guilt issues that why haven't I done this? Maybe I should have hoarded some more money. I should have thought about some other profession. So many a times people are thinking and wondering what they were doing were right or not. And that is creating a lot of guilt and anxiety in people. And the concept of existential anxiety. Is life meaningful? What is death? Are we? Do we have to really exist in this world in this way? And these are certain things which we have no answer for. And there's no treatment at this point of time. And that is creating a lot of anxiety in us. So maybe these are the certain specific reasons for this kind of a stress and anxiety at this point of time. So today in the morning in our daily Assam Tribune, I got this message. To keep the body in good health is a duty. Otherwise, we shall not be able to keep our mind strong and clear. Buddha. So Gautam Buddha had said rightly, today the health is the priority. Spiritual was always important, but at this point of time, our mental health as well as our physical health is to be preserved, more so by the health workers. If in crisis, take the support and heal thyself. I spent the past week talking to experts on mental health and COVID-19 from the West, and some of the people who said certain things are these I have just quoted from them. Number one, facts minimize fear. We should stay informed by trusted sources like WHO, national authority from each country. Second is, you must always return to yourself. That is, you are overly involved and you fall into just a sense of powerlessness. You must always return to yourself. Be aware of yourself and distinguish which emotions are yours, which are patients, and which are your empathy. I mean to say, people need to go back to themselves. At this point of time, people are in a state of disequilibrium. So we need to know how we were before and we have to go back to that routine life. Think about mental health as part of the public health response. people, mostly the healthcare professionals, are vulnerable because of the reasons all of you know, and also because some of the people have pre-existing mental illness, substance use, and that makes things very, very vulnerable and at risk. And some other vulnerable people, we all know the different kind of metabolic disorders, cancer, asthma, different kind of infections of the respiratory system. So we need to know about all those and make ourselves more adequate in our knowledge sphere. Social isolation is associated with poor mental health, but we need to understand that social distancing doesn't mean that we have to isolate from our near and dear ones. So we need to be connected. Compassion fatigue is another thing that I came to know about from them, that not to feel their pain. Sometimes what happens as health workers, we suddenly feel that we cannot feel their pain, and we become less empathetic and less compassionate. And that economic pressures will inevitably result in worse mental health. This is another person who said that, so we have to provide support after this pandemic is over, because a post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, would be very, very high, as predicted by other epidemics in the past, like Ebola, SARS, and others. Keeping our daily routines, which I already said, exercising regularly, practicing habits that we enjoy doing, and making judicious use of online tools and services is very important. And we need to also shift narratives. Somebody said that we have to shift the narratives away from the number of deaths towards number of recoveries. That is very important, how to talk about the positive but not the negative side of the story. And avoid the stigmatizing language, such as attaching religion or region or ethnicity. That should be avoided as much as possible. So what are the chances of you getting infected as healthcare professionals? High chance. But what are the chances of dying? You have to check the statistics and be informed. This is the statistics that I got from WHO, that from 10 to 19 years old, it is 0.2%. From 20 to 29 years old, it is 0.2%. But our age group is between 30 to 60. So here, it ranges from 0.2% to 1.3%, which is negligible. So we need to understand that the statistics shows that the mortality rate from this pandemic is quite low. So we need to make our facts very, very clear before getting utterly anxious and having the fear of death and dying. Here, there is another study that was published in Lancet, which had given importance to psychological interventions for people affected by COVID. Here, the frontline healthcare workers become the main personnel providing psychological interventions, because psychologists, psychiatric social workers, some of us, we cannot go into the isolation ward. And so because of that, the healthcare workers need to know about the psychological domain also. So when disease progresses, the clinical symptoms also change, and the psychological symptoms also needs different. We need to know about that the stress persists. Even when a person is cured and discharged from the hospital, there could be PTSD, so they have to be followed up. A professional team comprising mental health professionals is a basic tenet in dealing with emotional distress and other mental disorders caused by epidemic, is said by this article, which is published in Lancet. You can go through that. Another thing is that about when we come to this, we are in a crisis. This is not a very usual stress that we come across in life. It is a crisis. So I just want to give a brief account about what is crisis. Crisis is a perception of experiencing of an event or situation which is intolerable, difficulty that exceeds the person's current resources and coping mechanisms. But this is stated by James in 2008. He also states that unless an individual receives relief, the crisis has the potential to result in severe affective, behavioral, and cognitive malfunctioning. What does he mean by that? I'll come to that a little bit later, but what are the causes of crisis? We know the causes of crisis, that is intensely stressful, traumatic, hazardous event can cause crisis. And also an individual's perception of the event as the cause of considerable upset or disruption. And an individual's ability to resolve the disruption by previously used coping mechanisms are also very important to look at. What are the principles and characteristics of a crisis? Crisis embodies both danger as well as opportunity for the person experiencing the crisis. So we have an opportunity to work now. We are getting an opportunity. It's a challenge for all of us to get this and also to utilize our novel approaches. Time is limited here. It is very complex. It is difficult to resolve. The life experiences of the crisis enhance the workers' effectiveness. So sometimes what happens, this crisis is going to enhance our work effectiveness. We will be able to know how we can change our working style now that we are doing here in the web. This is something new for us. Quick fixes may not be applicable to many crisis situations. So crisis conference people with different kind of choices. So we are making different kind of choices, which is the best one for us. We need to first delineate. Emotional disequilibrium and disorganization accompany crisis. So three ways to respond to crisis. What are the three ways? Number one, in ideal circumstances, some individuals are able to effectively cope on their own and emerge stronger as a result of the experiences. Others appear to survive the crisis, but effectively block the pain from their awareness, resulting in ongoing impacts of the crisis. They may feel the crisis, but they block the pain of the crisis. Another set of individuals become immobilized at the time of crisis, and they become incapable of moving on with their lives unless provided with immediate and intensive intervention. This is the group that we have to deal with very, very intensively. First, we have to assess. Assessment is done in a very passive as well as in an active manner. Listening is very important, where you're going to attend, observe, understand, respond with empathy, genuineness, respect, acceptance. You have to non-judgmental and caring. All the basic principles of psychologists needs to be there. It is essential to establish an environment that provides individuals with psychological first aid, which is defined as the establishment of safety of the client, reducing stress-related symptoms, providing rest and physical recuperation, and linking clients to critical resources and social support system, which are very essential part of a helping process. There are six steps of crisis management. The first one is, first you have to define the problem. The first step is to define and understand what is the problem, what is the client's point of view. It is not your point of view because you can't assume what the client is feeling. So you need to understand from his perspective or her perspective and also ensure his or her safety, whether the person is safe, whether he has to be quarantined, whether isolation is required, or whether just a knowledge about what is happening is required. So you have to know about all those and also provide the support that is required in an emotional as well as instrumental and informational process. Active strategies are, you have to examine the alternatives. Ideally, collaborative process is important, but sometimes it doesn't work, then you have to direct them. Examining alternatives, like you have to assess the support from the family and friends. Does this client have any kind of a support? Does he require any kind of help to cope? What was his coping mechanisms? The coping mechanisms that he used to have, is it going to really help at this point of time? Are we going to really alter his thinking process? Or would we suggest him to continue because it seems to be very, very healthy at this point of time? So we have to examine and then give the alternatives. You have to make some plans, some detailed plans to outline the person, groups, and other referral resources that can be contacted in collaboration with a client in order that she feels a sense of ownership. What is very important is not to give advices just like that. You have to make the person feel a sense of ownership of the plan that you have devised for him. He or she has to have the sense of control and autonomy at all times. Facilitate them towards re-establishing a pre-crisis state of equilibrium. The commitments made by the client need to be voluntary and doable. A plan that has been developed by you will not be effective. There has to be some objective assessment that you need to do about the affective state. Is there any abnormal or impaired effect? What is the initial sign? Is he withdrawn? Is he emotionally out of control? What is his behavior? Is she able to sit calmly? Is she withdrawn, unresponsive? In crisis intervention, the quickest way to get the client to become mobile is to facilitate positive action that the client can take at once. The cognitive state is very, very important. Is he thinking coherently, logically? Are his words making any sense? All those are very important. What we need to understand is listening, because in crisis intervention, if you're talking about telecounseling, which I'm going to give a brief account of telecounseling methods and best practices, which we have devised here, is that we need to use open-ended questions in the beginning. It is helpful to start with what, how. Now, how do you feel? What do you think about it? Rather than, do you think like this or like that? So those kind of communication definitely doesn't help in the initial phase. Close-ended questions seek specific concrete information. Close-ended questions usually begin with verbs such as do, does, can you, have you, had. All those are very, very specific, and they are to be utilized in certain specific instances. Restatement and summary. By restating what the client has said in your own words can get clarification. You have to restate what the person had said. So like, you know, I think you have said this, isn't it? Something like that to clarify, because what he had said or what you have understood may have a vast difference. Owning feelings. I statements are important in crisis intervention because of the directive stance you may have to take with clients who are immobilized. For example, I'm not sure that I clearly understand the relationship between you and your partner. Can you tell me more about what happened? Something like that. Conveying understanding. I understand statement is one that conveys to the client that you do understand what is happening to them and what is causing them distress. That is very important to talk. Value judgment. We are told as clinical psychologists or as psychologists that we should not be judgmental. In certain times in crisis counseling, you need to value judgments, like in danger of hurting herself or someone else. The value judgment needs to focus on the behavior, not the client. For example, I'm very concerned when you talk about thinking about wanting to do something to your partner. What do you mean by that? So you're judging that that person is going to probably do something wrong. So you have assumed something and you're trying to judge. Positive reinforcement. Pointing out when a client is doing well is important. Good work. You've been able to take deep breaths in order to help calm yourself better. Now that you're more relaxed, you'll be able to think more clearly, something like that. Personal integrity and limit setting. It is important to set clear limits when clients get out of control. Example, I can see that you're very angry, but you cannot continue this behavior. If you continue, I will need to end our session and ask you to leave. Certain kind of limit setting is also required. I'm going to talk in telecounseling what you need to do. Assertion statement. Crisis intervention often means that you need to have the control of the situation. I want you to agree to not harm yourself and to sign this agreement, something like this. Facilitative listening involves focusing completely on the client's experience. You have told me that you want to leave your relationship, but I sense some sadness about your decision. Sometimes we have to know from the words what this person is feeling. So the feelings are not expressed in words, but you have to delineate from the words what kind of emotions that person must be having. Facilitated responding, which enables clients to gain a clear understanding of their feelings, help clients understand the full impact of the crisis situation. This allows clients to become more like objective external observers of the crisis. Like, for example, it appears like you're feeling stuck. I wonder what would happen if you could take a step back and look at your situation as though you were observing someone else. What would you say to that person? If your best friend was here right now, what would you do? So something like that, you come out of your status, come out of your space and look at yourself and then deal with the situation. There are four things that I want to focus on. Is the acronym called FACE. First is focus, awareness, connect, effective intervention. Means you have to focus on here and now. What is controllable is controllable. What is not controllable, you need not think about it. Like, for example, what about the disease, how long it is going on, how long it is going to be like this, what are the government measures, which are not under our control. So you need not think about that. Write them down in a diary, all your worries, and see what can be amenable and what cannot be amenable. Number two, awareness. What are the signs and symptoms which are normal and which are excessive? Be mindful. Like example, hand washing. When you're washing your hands, be mindful how you're washing it, how much soap you're giving, what is the sensation that you're feeling while washing your hands, something like that. Connect to people and friends with technology. A problem shared is a problem halved, which we all know. So express care and concern while staying together. We need not have conflicts at this point of time. Conflicts needs to be delayed and resolved later. At this point of time, we need to be united and do things together by connecting with the same effort, with the same intensity of positive emotions. Effective interventions, that is doable and feasible, like hobbies, restarting something new, pursuing academics, writing manuscripts, doing something which we have not done before. These are different kind of effective interventions. Now I'm going a little bit into telepsychological counseling because I believe there are 4 or 5 telepsychological counselors here. The most important thing in communication is hearing what is not said. It is said by Peter Drucker. So here, this is a catch, because what do the telecounseling people do? Generally, they have to hear what the other person is saying, and from the words, they have to infer what the person is feeling. That is a challenge. It is not so easy. Even in face-to-face counseling, it is not so easy to derive at the right perspective in treating that patient. But you can imagine the kind of a challenge in while doing telecounseling. Now we are in an operational phase. Counseling team had started responding to the distress calls. There's a lot of basic guidelines that people are trying to formulate. We are also trying to formulate certain things from our department. Teleconsultation requires counselors to be highly trained in counseling because words can kill a person. If you say something which is wrong, which may damage the person totally, so choose your words right and never be overconfident. While telepsychological counseling, why it is important? Because it is safe. Physical violence doesn't happen here. Use of technology can add more methods of documentation. It is reachable across boundaries. And the teleconsultation gives a lot of freedom and enables the doctor to use or her discretion based on clinical judgment to stop the consultation. Who can initiate teleconsultation? Any person in distress to registered counselor. Anybody can reach out for us. Caregiver, any caregivers or the people in distress can also reach out to you. Health workers, registered counselors can also do telecounseling with other counselors because of some special consultations. Process of consultation. It is only by telephone and not to meet anywhere else and use any other time. Helpline numbers has to be there. You all have to have the helpline numbers for food, different kind of medicines, police, women's health, child line. You need to keep all these numbers down. The consultations cannot be anonymous because both parties need to know each other's identity, even maybe by identification proof. It is client-centered. And the best approach be taken in maintaining confidentiality. We have to maintain the confidentiality. Same guidelines have to be followed as face-to-face counseling. It is similar to any kind of face-to-face counseling in maintaining the confidentiality issues. Detailed assessment is taken only by interview method. Responder has to be very soft-spoken, should have good communication skills. Local language is desirable. Emotional support and connection to the callers needs to be established in the first call itself. The responder displays empathic listening, non-judgmental listening, non-discriminatory interaction. The responder should maintain the respect. There should not be any discussion on political and religious issues. The team will explore solutions using a collaborative interaction. That is, you need to know all the stress management techniques, coping strategies, all the different kind of problem-solving strategies. There are follow-up calls to check on safety and well-being of the callers. You need to find out if a person is suicidal. If you had given some instructions, did he do that? You have to do some follow-up calls also. Sometimes the person has to take up those phone calls or tell the superiors that this is what you have heard. Refuse to share any kind of delusions and hallucinations by doing anything with them because they need medicines. So you have to take the numbers of the DMHP personals and seek for information and give the informations on all the numbers of the people who are practicing medicines. Keep the expectations realistic. Maintain the professional boundaries and the distance. Avoid placating. It is better to empathically respond to a caller and explore the past coping mechanism and focus on the caller's strengths rather than the weaknesses. Assess the lethality. I'm telling it again and again, always assess lethality. Because if you find there is irrational thinking, there is high death wish, suicidal ideas, you need to take it as an emergency. Slow the emotions down by focusing on here and now issues that are concrete and reality oriented. The counselor has a discretion to decide the mode. Sometimes in text can use audio messages. Also, if it is not from government sector, if you as a person is doing some kind of telecounseling, psychological sessions, you can have your own discretion to use different kind of videos or digital images in order to deal with the issue with a mixed method. What to do when patient calls for telemedicine consultation? Definitely, it is for crisis intervention. And also, telemedicine consultation is permitted in India as per certain guidelines. So you need to tell the clients who are using medicines not to misuse the psychiatry medicines, and also to see some YouTube videos. There are some telemedicine best practices done from NIMHANS by Dr. Suresh Padamat. You can go through that. He has given 4, 10 to 12 videos. So you can go through that. He has given some best practices in telemedicine to know about the medicines by the concerned doctors. Problem callers. There are times when regular, severely disturbed or abusive callers may call you. The crisis line should not cater to a caller's every whim and fantasy and deviant behavior. So you need to set limits for regular callers if it is possible to acknowledge their needs, but also not be controlled by them. You are most helpful when you show that you are not willing to be manipulated or abused by them. So in these situations, you need to do this. Pose some open-ended questions like, what did you hope to get from calling the crisis line? Set limits. When attempts to refocus the problem back to the caller do not work, it can be helpful to set some limits. We can talk about your situation for 5 minutes and then I need to take another call, something like that. Terminate abuse. It is okay to interrupt an abusive call and inform the caller that you're ending the call and invite them to call back when they can communicate appropriately. Do not give in to abuse by any callers. Switch workers. If you're having a difficult time with a caller and there is another worker available, it is okay to say to the caller that you're transferring the call to someone who's better able to assist them. So ethical standards has to be maintained at all times. The helpline team should be sensitized to certain limits of involvement. Meeting callers privately or exchanging personal information should be avoided and not done. Discussing calls with relatives and friends should be avoided. You should not discuss any of your calls with anybody rather besides the treating team. Telling callers to follow a specific religious practice or political issue, not done. No tolerance for non-conformity to the ethics of helpline duties. If you have certain ethics of the helpline duties, you have to conform to that and cannot do things by yourself without the permission. So the brief screening tool that can be utilized here is, number one, person details. What you have to do when a person is quarantined, you can just check for the name, age, phone number, make a call and ask for the specific person and talk to him only. Introduce like this. I am a psychiatrist or I'm a psychologist or I'm a psychiatric social worker currently working in Guwahati Medical College and calling on behalf of the government of Assam Health Department. Is this a good time to speak or can you spare a few minutes with me? If he says yes, proceed to the next. If he says no, ask whether you can call at any other specific time. Please note it down. If they don't reply, end the call, proceed to SMS option. The helpline will be operational 24 hours and shift duties will be given to the team members. Automated call routine will be preferable to ensure that immediate help is provided according to the availability of the counselors in each zone. The callers are discouraged from continued contact with the same counselor. Callers are encouraged to be comfortable with any available counselor. Why is training of trainers important? As crisis helplines are emotionally demanding and may bring about burnout, it is important to involve mentoring and supervision to young counselors. The main skills such as non-judgmental support and reassurance are very, very important. The counselor should be informed about the various facts and myths related to COVID-19. You have to know all the facts and myths. Write it down in a paper when the calls comes. The ability to handle stress reactions such as anxiety, depression, somatization associated with epidemic outbreaks will be dealt with by the third speaker. She's going to talk about the different mechanisms to deal with anxiety and stress. Grief and loss issues could also be there. So you have to do brief resolution of grief sometimes. Supervision important, that is a conclusion. Supervision is essential to ensure quality and adequate support for the well-being of the counselor, helpline worker on from mental health professionals. There are four areas of supervision: debriefing and support after a call to help the responder with emotional reactions and difficulties encountered during the call. Sometimes we as healthcare professionals, if we had seen a patient or we had dealt with a call, we need to sit back with other colleagues of ours and we need to debrief. We need to do some kind of cognitive restructuring because it may burn us down. Providing feedback so that the responder improves the skills. Assist the responder in record keeping procedure to ensure that the caller gets the appropriate and useful help. language is very, very important. Identify the language the person is most comfortable with and then talk about it. Listen, please start with an open-ended question like, are there any stress? Do you have any concerns? Are any issues bothering you? Let them ventilate over the next few minutes about the concerns. Hear them out. They may shout at you. They may scold at you. That means counseling is working. Do not think that people getting aggressive means you're not doing a good job. That means it is working. Because can you imagine when sometimes people call us at odd hours for marketing their products, how do we behave? So something like that. They're all stressed out, so you have to go with the flow. Educate about facts. Facts and only facts. Generally provide them with the available facts about the situation, quarantine, what is happening, like what is the statistics in India right now. Normalize their concerns and what the individuals are facing. Reassure. Provide reassurance that their problems are noted and would be appraised to the concerned authority. Convey that help and support is available 24/7. Reiterate the emergency contact numbers. Appreciate. It is vital to appreciate the efforts that they are already making and reinforce that and say that you're helping the society by isolating yourselves. Be safe. This is an assessment tool that I have made. You can just note it down. This is something to do about how you're going to ask questions. Do you have any anxiety, fear, panic, tension, worry? Yes or no. Do you feel low, sad, tearful, hopeless, helpless, worthless, guilty? Yes or no. Do you get death wish or suicidal thought? Yes or no. Is your sleep disturbed? Yes or no. So on a scale of 0 to 10, how severe is your stress? Again, from 0 to 10, he has to, if it is yes, then you have to deal with the issue. Open-ended question. Ask them how they're spending time and provide specific tips like avoiding excessive social media, daytime naps, exercise that could be done at home, books, music, movies, reach relatives over phone. Please innovate your own ideas to create something new and give something new to the clients. Contact details has to be given, advice for help. Last slide. There are certain tips that I've just written for the crisis counselors. Always use headphones because it is immensely painful when you hold the phone onto your ears and 45 minutes you're going to listen to them. So start buying headphones with mic. Do not carry over previous caller's anger with the next call. Do not show any kind of displacement of anger to anybody at home or to the callers. Ask for help from superiors and seek for information. If you can't help them, tell them you will call back after some time, after some inquiry. Because if you don't know something, say you don't know, you will get back. But don't give mixed messages and false messages. Note down the mobile number then quickly and pass this to your superior or the supervisor to help them out. Thank you very much for a very, very wonderful. Thank you. And the next presenter will be the psychiatric social worker from our department. Thank you.
A very good afternoon. I am Dr. Bornali Das from Department of Psychiatry, Guwahati Medical College. And today my topic, as you know, is on stress management. And we would also go through the emotions and the breakdown that from time to time that we have to handle. So it is to manage the emotional health of an individual. So the presentation would go in this way. Like today, we know that much of here are the frontline workers or person, those who are handling in a day-to-day basis. So why are we important? What about COVID and the government measures? What are the stages of psychosocial impact? How you can protect yourself physically and emotionally? How you can protect various target groups of people? and experience of mindfulness, I will give you a demonstration out there. So why is it important to prevent, and whether you will be able to cure, that is a question. But however, there will be a lot of ways coming in contact. Sometimes we may know, sometimes we may not know. From monitored, mapped hand washing practices and self-hygiene practices, which are already standardized and taught. What about the COVID-19? As we know, this comes from the SARS and MERS community, from these, and then it gives various symptoms of fever, nasal congestion. This already you all know, so I'll just skip this slide. What are the stages of the psychosocial factors, how the impact are done? So this is what I have made, that first we are in the fear zone. Then we come to the bargain zone. We ask ourselves what we are doing. We analyze, procrastinate, and also overgeneralize. Then we learn, and then growth zone. So when we are in the fear zone, then there are a lot of hypervigilance on ourselves. There is, because there are isolation, people have to go back to for the isolation, those who come to the contact, or either they have to go to quarantine. This becomes a havoc in managing the families, and that you are facing it in the community. So loss of movement, that is another fear for any individual at this present moment of the pandemic, and loss of employment. What will happen in the future? How would they survive? How would they, and if they are contractual employees and the migrant laborers, then the issues are even more difficult for them. Then comes the bargaining, that what is in their hand? There is a lot of analysis and also reanalysis of the situation, and they somehow come to the bargaining mode, and then procrastinate that what we would do in the future. This is also a state of worrying and overgeneralization, and then comes to a learning phase where they come to a fruitful choice, make a choice, positive schedules, like they rearrange their days, rearrange their timings, connect with the nature and the family, and then come to a productive work. And then we would like to go into a growth stage, which is yet to happen, or some are already in the practice. Like the families are now working there in their own rescheduling themselves in some work. So here and now approach, learning new skills to develop it, like engaging children, engaging the other family members, developing new habits, and also think much more and far beyond, that is the altruistic thinking. So not only to doing or saving himself, like suppose somebody buys certain things, he would also buy two, three families in that compound. So these are altruistic kind of mechanism that one is going through this various psychosocial stages. So how you can protect your physical health? So first and foremost, this has been a little bit covered by the earlier speaker, like properly eat, exercise, rest, sleep adequately, and do not take any other preventive measures. Like as a health worker, there is also tendency or the knowledge of certain medication, and it should not be a self-medicated, or one should not take certain medication without proper consultation with the doctor. Wash to kill the virus for 30 seconds, wash with soap, water, using sanitizer. This is not for only for oneself, but also teaching this in the community, and to reiterate into the fact that a person needs to bring into the focus many a times. Social distance should be maintained. Mask should be put by every individual. And then also work on the sneezing, coughing, or the mouth and not in the public. Ensure their respiratory hygiene. So for the frontline workers, those who are doing a great job are definitely stressed, that we understand. You are also a human, and it is fine to be stressed. Emotional aspect of this is practice attach the cause and detach with the person. So when we work, we are working for the cause, and we need to be detached from with whom you are working. So cope with connection, network to speak, and listen and get back to the normalcy. For psychiatric social workers, it is even more important because networking at this present scenario is very important to have the knowledge about in and around of the district, because that will help the person to get back to the community and to work in the community in a better mode if you have the knowledge. So there are a lot of already IEP materials. We should follow only few, like the World Health Organization or CDC, or from the Ministry of Family and Health Welfare. So that those are the important areas. So we need to be respectful. You can go through this. Anyways, I will leave the slide. So how to protect the individuals emotionally? Time should be disciplined and detox. So as we already have gone through, eat nutritious and simple food with non-fatty or junk. Drink a lot of juices and water. Hydrate yourself. Avoid alcohol and drugs, which induce depression. Or physical exercise, household chores, cardio, yoga, stretching, breathing exercise. These are for the adults, which the advice has been given. Cognitive exercises like chess, games, crosswords, Sudoku can be done. Relaxation exercise like meditation, chanting, and praying. Today, I'll be teaching you the mindfulness meditation, which I'll be following it a little later. Bring out your own creative abilities. Develop serious leisure activity like hobbies of writing, painting, stitching, knitting, or connecting with people. Surprise your family members whom you have not connected for a long time, or the friends whom you have not connected. Learn new skills. Challenge yourself to do something little different, because the stereotypical work of day-to-day life may also make it very hazardous for oneself as well as the family members around. Reorganize your house and thus reorganize your mind. Start the day by listening and reading positive stories and before reading about any of the COVID news. Practice listening to COVID news twice a day from the government sources like WHO, MHA, or from CDC or the state government. Avoid negative news. It only makes the mind more stressful and sometimes into paranoia. How to protect the senior citizens in an emotional context? So isolation would be the best advice, which would reduce the vulnerability. Along with this, whatever I have covered earlier, isolate for minimum contact with persons who has a history of lung condition. Monitor the medical condition from time to time. They should have their tele numbers. Like 104 is an important number at this point of time. Ensure the access to the tele online medical facilities. Time for the discipline and create a new environment. This is for the children, because much of the children at home become bored, not allowed to go out to the compound. So this can be advice which you can give from your telephones or from your home context in your district. So first and foremost, if you have seen the person, one or two children can come in together and their own brothers and sisters, if they are two, then they can play, or keep them engaged into various creative abilities. Develop serious leisure activities of hobbies of different kinds, and like painting, like doing new things of sketching, which they might have not done it earlier, or sometimes narrative. Over the phone, they can narrate it to somebody else about the stories, and learn new skills and challenge yourself to do something different. Reorganize your house and thus reorganize your mind. Allow the child to space the express of fear. They may be fearful because they're getting a lot of noise, lot of information from their elderlies, and also information from their parents. So keep them away from such kind of things. Extreme fears can turn to be long-term problems like bedwetting, eating disorders, etc. Limit to exposure of negative news. Limit the time on the online games. How to protect person with disability and emotionally? We have covered adults, we have covered children. Now we are also covering the disabled person. They should not be left out because they are the important members of the society too. So ensure that the service that we are giving or was giving, it has to be continued. COVID does not mean that we are leaving behind the other disabled or intellectually disabled or with differently abled people. So ensure the continuing service. Neglect of service can be aggravate the disability. Ensure access to the medical facilities. Plan for alternative caregivers if they can, caregivers can come in centers for the care of the people with disability. Look out for the aggravated emotional stress. Look out for the increase in the abusive situation. See that they are not being abused. See that they are in touch with the healthy folks of the community through over the phone or over your calls to them. So with this, I would like to end my talk. But however, before mindfulness, I would request all of you to sit behind to your chair, relax for a moment, and we will go from step to step process in order to de-stress. And this I will again leave back so that you can practice it to your clients in whomever you come in context or whomever you come in contact. So find a comfortable sitting place with your back straight and not rigid, allowing the body to just breathe in naturally, bringing the attention to the most noticeable point of touch, where the breath makes contact as it enters the nostril. Bring the awareness to the sense of touch. You can focus onto your nose or the nostrils that the air is passing in and the warm air passing out. Active inhalation and exhalation. Keep your attention at one precise point and note that the sensation that accompanies each breath as it flows in and flows out in a natural breathing process. If the attention strays, it is obvious that the mind may stray away. Bring it back to the point where you notice that the breath comes in and goes out through your nostrils, noting the breathing in and breathing out. Not judging and not thinking about the breath, not even visualizing it, just being with the sensation as it arises with the touch of the air passing in and out of the nostrils. Sound arises, the thoughts also arise. Other sensations also arise. So let them be there as it is. The law of impermanence. Let them be there. As it arises, it will also fade away. It will pass by. In the foreground of moment-to-moment awareness of the sensation, the breath coming in and going out, do not push it away. Just clear, precise, gentle observation of the breath. This is the mindfulness of breathing. The sensation arises in the body. Thought also arise in the mind. They come and go like bubbles. Allowed to arise and allowed to pass away of its own momentness to the sensation always present with coming and going out of the breath. Gently returning to the nostrils, the awareness of the breath in the foreground. In the background, everything else is as it is. Each breath is unique. Sometimes deep, sometimes shallow, always slightly changing. The whole breath felt going in, stopping, and also coming out. The whole breath experienced at the level of sensation of touch. Breathing just happening by itself. Awareness simply watching the breath as it come in and out. Eyes to be soft or relaxed, face relaxed, shoulders loose, the belly full and easy. Do not hold it. It does its own way of, and it has its own practice of doing. Do not hold anywhere. Just bring it to your awareness and then breathing. Just consciousness and mind. Do not get lost in the mind pulls away gently with soft, non-judging and non-clinging awareness. Return to the breath, not the whole breath, but from its beginning to its end, precisely and clearly, from sensation to sensation. The body arises, the mind thinks, awareness simply observes the process of getting it and lost in the content. Each breath is unique and each moment is completely new. If sensation should arise in the body, let the awareness recognize its sensation. Notice it coming and notice it going, not thinking of it as a body or a leg or a pain or a vibration. Simply noting the sensation and returning to the breath. The whole process occurring by itself. Awareness, observing, moment to moment, the arising and passing away of experiences in the mind and the body and moment to moment change. Surrender to the present. Experience the breath. Don't try to force yourself by thinking it over again. Don't even think of the concentration. Just allow to come in and go out in the level of sensation that arise themselves and disappear by itself. The point of touch becoming more and more distant, more intense, with the coming and going of each breath. The mind becoming one-pointed on sensation that accompanies breathing. If the thought arises, clearly note their motion is also in the mind, rising and passing away like a bubble. Notice them and to return to the mindfulness of breathing. If thought or feeling becomes predominant with your open awareness, softly note what is predominant, feeling or thinking, as hearing or tasting or as smelling. Then gently return to your breath. Entering and passing of the feeling of any sense arising in the moment and passing away in the next moment. Watch it in motion, the continual change from object to object, breath to breath, sensation to sensation. Moment to moment, objects arise and passes away in the vast space of mind and body. Make each of the area light, loose, and free-flowing as an easy, open awareness, simply observing the process of arising and passing away. Awareness of whatever is predominant, returning to the sensation of the breath. Sound arises and passes away. Feeling arises and passes away. All of who we are, of what we think, we are moment to moment, coming and going. Observe as it is and let it pass through. Keep yourself calm for some moment before coming to the alertness. This can be practiced by all the frontline workers, by every health professional, and also can be given to the clients who comes in contact who are disturbed or vulnerable. Thank you so much. Thank you for giving this as a platform.
Shamanta, that a question thakibo pare, haki question likhibo pare. Namaskar. মই আকৌ ডক্টৰ মাইথিলী হাজৰিকা আহিছোঁ অলপমান কথাখিনি অসমীয়াত ক'বলৈ আৰু আপোনালোকৰ যদি কিছুমান কথা আছে সুধিবলৈ আমাক ডক্টৰ শ্যামন্ত দাস আছে ডক্টৰ বৰ্ণালী আছে মই আছোঁ যদি আছে আপোনালোকে লিখি দিব পাৰে ইউ অল কেন ৰাইট ইট ডাউন টেক্সট মেছেজ টু আছ ইফ ইউ হেভ এনি কুৱেৰিজ এনিথিং টু স্পেচিফিকেলি টু চামবডি এনি ইছ্যুজ দেট ইউ ৱান্ট টু ডিছকাছ উই হেভ 25 মিনিটছ আমাৰ 25 মিনিট আছে সময় আপোনালোকে লিখিব পাৰে আমি চাই ল'ম এতিয়া কথাখিনি অলপমান থুলমূলকে মই ক'ব খুজিছো যে মানে এতিয়া টেলি কাউন্সেলিং যোনটো বস্তু আমি যোনটো এইটো নতুন বস্তু এটা এইটো আমাৰ কাৰণেই আমি ইমান বছৰ চাকৰি কৰি 20 years আই থিংক দিছ ইজ দ্য ফাৰ্ষ্ট টাইম মই প্ৰথম আমি টেলি চাইক'লজিকেল কাউন্সেলিং আৰু এনেকুৱা এটা বিষয় লৈ কৰিব ওলাইছো সেইটো ইমান ইজি নহয় ইমান সহজ নহয় সেইকাৰণে আমি অকণমান কথা জানি থোৱাটো উচিত মই অলৰেডি ক'লোৱেই ইংলিছত কৈছিলোঁ আগৰখিনি কিছুমান বস্তু হয়তো বা বুজিবলৈ টান হ'ব পাৰে মই সেইকাৰণে অকণমান থুলমূলকৈ ক'ব খুজিছোঁ যে যেতিয়া আমি ফোনটো লওঁ আমি এইটো খুব ইম্পৰ্টেণ্ট এইটো খুবেই জানিব লাগে যে ফোনটো লোৱাৰ লগে লগে আমি অভাৰ কনফিডেন্স যে আমি পাৰিমেই যি ক'ব সেইটো আমি কৈ দিম আমি হেণ্ডেল কৰিব পাৰিম এনেকৈ নলৈ পেলাই অলপমান ৰখিব লাগিব শুনিব লাগিব কথাখিনি কি কৈছে লিচনিংটো খুব ইম্পৰ্টেণ্ট মানে কেনেকৈ কৈছে কথাখিনি কোনে কৈছে আমি এতিয়া কি বিচাৰিছে তেখেতসকলে আমাৰ পৰা সেইকাৰণে অলপমান ভাবি ল'ব লাগিব ভাবি পেলাই উত্তৰটো দিয়াৰ আগতে অলপমান চিন্তা কৰি উত্তৰটো দিব লাগে আৰু উত্তৰটো দিয়াৰ আগতে এইটো জানিব লাগে যে আমি সেইখিনি আমাৰ ইনফৰ্মেশ্যন আছেনে নাই আমি সেই কথাখিনি একচুৱেলি আমি জানো নে নাজানো ভালকৈ নে আমাৰ চ'ৰ্চ অফ ইনফৰ্মেশ্যনটো ক'ৰ পৰা লৈছোঁ আমি সেইকাৰণে সকলোকে মই ক'ম সকলোকে সকলোৱে যেন অকণমান গোটেই কথাবোৰ ক'ভিড-19ৰ বিষয়ে কিছুমান কথা সুধিবও পাৰে ইনফৰ্মেশ্যনো ল'ব বিচাৰিব পাৰে সেইকাৰণে লৈ থোৱা ভাল হাতত সদায় নোট পেঞ্চিল গোটেইখিনি লিখি থৈ দিব লিখি পেলাই চবৰে হেল্পলাইন নাম্বাৰ্ছবিলাক মই কৈছোৱেই সব হেল্পলাইন নাম্বার সবরে পুলিশৰ হক উইমেন সেন্টাৰ হক চাইল্ডৰ হক সৰু সৰু ল'ৰা ছোৱালী প্ৰব্লেমৰ কাৰণেও ফোন কৰিব পাৰে এইখিনি লিখি থৈ দিব আৰু সুইচাইড হেল্পলাইনটো মই কৈছোৱেই আমাৰ চাইক'লজিকেল এটা কাউন্সেলিং চেণ্টাৰ এটা নতুনকৈ এতিয়া আৰম্ভ কৰিব ওলাইছোঁ অহাকালি বা পৰহিৰ পৰা সেইটো অ'পেন হ'ব 6টা নাম্বাৰ এইটো চাইক'লজিকেল ক্ৰাইচিছ কাউন্সেলিং চেণ্টাৰ হিচাপে এইটো পুলিচৰ দ্বাৰা হ'ব আমাৰ চাইকিয়াট্ৰিক ডিপাৰ্টমেণ্টৰ ডিপাৰ্টমেণ্ট অফ চাইকিয়াট্ৰি উইথ দ্য হেল্প অফ দ্য পুলিচ চ' মই এইটো ক'ব খুজিছোঁ যে কাউন্সিলাৰ্ছখিনি অলপমান সজাগ হোৱাটো খুব ইম্পৰ্টেণ্ট এইকাৰণে ইম্পৰ্টেণ্ট যে বাৰ্ণ আউট হৈ যাব একেবাৰে খুবেই ভাগৰ লাগি যাব আৰু কলছবিলাক এনেকুৱা আহিব বহু ধৰণৰ আহিব আৰু সেইকাৰণে কিছুমান আহিব হতাশাৰ প্ৰব্লেম আহিব পাৰে কিছুমান খুব ৰেষ্টলেছনেছৰ প্ৰব্লেম আহিব পাৰে এংজাইটি যোনটো আমি কৈছোঁ হাতত ঘামি যোৱা ঘামি গৈ আছে হাতখন বুলি কিছুমান এনেকুৱা ফিজিকেল চিম্পটমছ পেট বিষাব পাৰে মূৰ বিষাব পাৰে বা এনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ কথা ক'ব পাৰে যে মই বাৰে বাৰে সঘনাই মই টয়লেটত যাবলগীয়া হৈছে ফ্ৰিকুৱেণ্ট ইউৰিনেশ্যন বুলি কোৱা যায় সেইবিলাক কিছুমান চিম্পটমছ আহি যাব পাৰে এইবিলাক এংজাইটিৰ কাৰণে হ'ব পাৰে বা ক'ব পাৰে যে মই টোপনি অহা নাই শুব পৰা নাই তেতিয়া কি কৰিব লাগিব এতিয়া শ্লীপ হাইজিনৰ কথা ক'ব লাগিব যে টোপনি যদি অহা নাই তেতিয়াহ'লে আমি কেনেকৈ শ্লীপ হাইজিন মেথডছবিলাক জানিব লাগিব যে এটা পাৰ্টিকুলাৰ টাইমত হ'ব লাগিব ৰাতি যেন এটা নিৰ্দিষ্ট সময় লৈ লয় শোৱা টাইম এটা আৰু এক্সাৰচাইজ কৰে কিয়নো ৰুমৰ ভিতৰত সোমাই থাকিলে মানুহৰ কি হ'ব যদি বিচনাতে পৰি থাকে তেতিয়া টোপনি নাহিব পাৰে সেইকাৰণে বহুত ধৰণৰ শ্লীপ হাইজিন মেথডছ আছে সেইবিলাক পঢ়িব লাগিব কফি হয়তো বা চাহ এইবিলাক আবেলিৰ পৰা খাব নালাগিব লাইট মিউজিক আবেলি শুনিব লাগিব এনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ কিছুমান টেকনিক সৰু সুৰা ক'ব লাগিব তেতিয়া সেনেকৈ যোনটো প্ৰব্লেম যেনেকৈ সোধে সেনেকৈ উত্তৰটো দিব লাগে আৰু এটা কথা চাব লাগে যে কিছুমান মানুহ আত্মহত্যা কৰাৰ কথা কৈছে নেকি যে মোৰ এনেকুৱা এটা ষ্টেটত আহি গৈছোঁ যে ফাইনেন্সৰ প্ৰব্লেম খুব হৈছে মানুহৰ সেইকাৰণে ইকনমিক প্ৰব্লেমৰ কাৰণে আমি চবেই জানো যে যদি কেনেবাকৈ খোৱা লোৱা নাপাওঁ ঘৰত হাংগাৰ খাব পোৱা নাই ভাল একোৱে খাব পোৱা নাই যদি ভাত দালি চাউল পৰ্যন্ত পোৱা নাই যদি তেতিয়াহ'লে এইটো চাব লাগিব যে সেইটো কেনেকৈ পাব তেওঁলোকে ক'ত আপোনালোকে ডাইৰেক্ট কৰি দিব পাৰিব যে ৰেচন টেচন পোৱা সেইকাৰণে সেই নাম্বাৰ্ছবিলাক লাগিব চ' এভৰিথিং হেজ টু বি told to them kyano enuka dhona basic problem bilakor karone phone koribo pare ar sei basic problem or karone hoyto ba teluk hoyto suicidal hoy goise bole khaboi jodi pua nai ji ai thaki ki lab so henuka dhona kotha hobo pare aru eta hobo pare je be parwa mane ji hoy hobo aru hetu eta ami jontu ko suicidal intention type ore hoy goi je হলে হ'ব মোৰ একো নাই ময়ো মৰিম বেলেগো মৰিব এনেকুৱা টাইপৰ কিছুমান এটিটিউড সেইটো চাব লাগিব যিটো এগ্ৰেশ্যনটো ক'ৰ পৰা হৈছে সেনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ কিন্তু এছেচমেণ্ট মই অলৰেডি টুল এখন দিছোঁ যদি কাৰোবাৰ ডিপ্ৰেছড লাগে চেড লাগে অশান্তি লাগি আছে মনত টোপনি অহা নাই খোৱা লোৱা ভালকৈ কৰা নাই যদি য়েছ বুলি কৈছে তেতিয়াহ'লে অকণমান দীঘলীয়াকৈ কথা পাতিব লাগিব কিছুমানে হয়তো বা এনেই ফোন কৰিব পাৰে মই যোনটো কৈছোঁ প্ৰব্লেম কলাৰ্ছ সেইবিলাক আমি আইডেণ্টিফাই কৰিব লাগিব যে তেওঁলোকক আমি কেনেকৈ মেনেজ কৰোঁ তেওঁলোকে যদি বাৰ বাৰ ফোন কৰি থাকে এনেই আমাৰ টাইম ৱেষ্ট কৰি আছে তেতিয়াহ'লে আমি কেনেকৈ তেওঁলোকক মানা কৰাটো উচিত যে আমি হয়তো এনেকৈ ক'ব লাগিব যে মই আৰু আপোনাৰ লগত 5 মিনিটে কথা পাতিব পাৰিম বা 2 মিনিট কথা পাতিব পাৰিম ইয়াৰ পিছত কিন্তু মই ফোনটো বন্ধ কৰি দিম আপোনালোকৰ কি কথা আছে মোক এতিয়া কওক আৰু নেক্সট টাইম যেন আকৌ ফোন নকৰে একেটা কথাৰ কাৰণে এনেকুৱা ধৰণৰ কিছুমান ষ্ট্ৰেট কিছুমান লিমিটেশ্যন লিমিট ছেটিং কৰিব লাগিব সেইখিনি মানুহৰ লগত সেনেকৈ কিছুমান টেলি কাউন্সেলিঙৰ কিছুমান বেছিক গাইডলাইনছ বনোৱা হৈছে সেইখিনি আমি হয়তো বা শ্বেয়াৰ কৰিম কিয়নো টেলি কাউন্সেলিং শুনাত মানে বস্তুটো ভাবিবলৈ ইজি যে ফোনত কথা পাতিম হৈ যাব আৰু কিন্তু চবতকৈ ডিফিকাল্ট এইটোৱে যে আমি মানুহজনক দেখা নাপাওঁ আমি যেতিয়া দেখা নাপাওঁ মানুহক তেতিয়া কি হৈ যায় বহুখিনি অসুবিধা কিন্তু মই যদি এটা কথা কৈ দিলোঁ আজি আৰু মই যদি ভুল ক'লো তেতিয়াহ'লে ওচৰত যদি মানুহজন থাকে তেতিয়াহ'লে আমি আকৌ উল্টাই লৈ ল'ব পাৰোঁ চৰি বা ভুল হৈ গ'ল মই এনেকৈ ক'ব নালাগিছিলে কথাটো হয়তো বা মই ভুল বুজিলোঁ আপোনাৰ কথাটো আমি ক'ব পাৰোঁ সেইটো উই কেন ৰিভাৰ্ছ বেক লৈ ল'ব পাৰোঁ কথাখিনি কিন্তু টেলি কাউন্সেলিঙত পটককৈ এটা কৈ দিয়াৰ পিছত যদি লাইনটোৱে কাট খাই গ'ল বা আমি যদি ভুল কথা এটা কৈ দিলোঁ পটককৈ সেইটো লৈ লোৱাটো বহুত দিগদাৰী সেইকাৰণে সেই গাইডলাইনছবিলাক অকণমান আপোনালোকে চাব লাগিব আৰু আৰু এটা আমাৰ ৱেবছাইট আছে সোমহিল আমাৰ ছ'চাইটি এখন আছে ছ'চাইটি অফ মেণ্টেল হেল্থ ইন লোৱাৰ ইন মিডল ইনকাম কাউণ্ট্ৰিজ বুলি আপোনালোকে তাৰে সোমহিল হৈছে আমাৰ এটা ছ'চাইটি সেই ছ'চাইটিখনৰ হা এই সোসাইটিখন হৈছে এখন মেণ্টেল হেলথৰ ওপৰত কৰা সোসাইটি, তাতে মই প্ৰেচিডেণ্ট, ডক্টৰ শ্যামন্ত দাস আছে, ডক্টৰ বৰ্ণালী দাস আছে। এইটো ৱেবছাইট এটা দি দিওঁ, somhill@hotmail.com, দেট ইজ SOM, আপোনালোকে লিখি ল'ব পাৰে SOMHIL, S Society, O Society of Mental, M Health, H I in L মানে ইসলামিক কান্ট্রি, সো somhill@hotmail.com, তাতে আপোনালোকৰ কিবা কুৱেৰি থাকিলে আপোনালোকে লিখিব পাৰে, আমি তাতে আমাৰ উত্তৰবোৰ দিম। আৰু যিকোনো ধৰণৰ কথা থাকিলে, ইনফেক্ট এতিয়া আপোনালোকে কিছুমান গাইডলাইনছৰ কথা সুধিব পাৰে, আমাৰ SOP এটা বনাইছে ডিপাৰ্টমেণ্ট অফ চাইকিয়াট্ৰি, সেইটো আমি শ্বেয়াৰ কৰিব পাৰিম। আৰু থেংক ইউ, আৰু কিবা যদি আৰু থাকি গ'ল কথা, শ্যামন্ত আৰু বৰ্ণালী, ডু ইউ ৱান্ট টু এড সামথিং? Okay, we'll meet with your queries. আমাৰ অলপমান টাইম থাকি গ'ল, আমাৰ ইণ্টাৰেক্টিভ ছেশ্যন হ'ব বুলি ভাবিছিলোঁ, কিন্তু ইয়াতে ইণ্টাৰেক্টিভ ছেশ্যন যিহেতু নহ'ল, আপোনালোকক এই নাম্বাৰ এই মেইলটো দিয়া হৈছে, তাতে লিখিলে হ'ল। থেংক ইউ, ধন্যবাদ।
অখিলেশ, অখিলেশ, হ্যালো অখিলেশ।